Obviously, there's been a lot said about last week's leaked draft of the Supreme Court opinion that appears to overturn Roe versus Wade. And there's been a lot of blame that's been going around. But one of the groups that has kind of escaped a little bit of accountability is the media. And joining me now to talk about this is Sharon Kann. She is the Senior Director of Innovation and Impact at Media Matters. And Sharon, you have written a phenomenal article that I've read now like three or four times because I just love it. I love the way it's written. But the media, their role in all of this, almost as deep, I guess, as the Republican role, because it goes back just as long. And I want you to lay this out for us because you do it so much more beautifully than I could. So tell us about this article here.
Hi. Yeah, thank you very much. I think a note of context before getting into the article, before I was the Senior Director of Innovation and Impact at Media Matters, I ran our reproductive rights and abortion health team, which means that for sort of as long as I've been at this organization, I've been looking at, analyzing, and having conversations with people in the field about the role that media plays in sort of shaping people's understanding of important topics. In particular, for things like abortion access and rights, how the issue is framed, not just in right-wing media, but in mainstream media, is critical for people's understanding. And sort of the thesis of my article was that, yes, there is a lot of conversation to be had about the role that years and years of right-wing messaging, political organizing, and media organizing had in sort of getting us to this moment, but that mainstream media and outlets that you might think of as neutral, or at least as sort of standard bearers for accurate information, have kind of played a role both actively and tacitly in getting us to this point.
And, you know, that's a great point, too, because obviously we know how conservative media talks about this issue, right? They're all on the same side. They're on the same team. They've got the same talking points that they've been spitting out to us for, you know, a couple decades now. But when you get into the CNNs and the MSNBCs, you know, MSNBC is viewed as the more left-leaning network, CNN kind of hovering in between there. But it's not just the way that they've talked about it or framed it, but in many cases, as you point out here, not talked about it. And mm-hmm. I think that is a very interesting point as well that a lot of people forget about. While we have these right-wing outlets that push these issues, you know, use it to drum up their base, sometimes we do get silence from the other side. And to me, it's a bit of a tricky thing, right? You don't want to spend 100% of your time just having to debunk these right-wing talking points. But at the same time, you cannot just let them flourish, because when they go just unrebutted, they grow and grow until you've got a problem on your hands that, you know, leads to what we're seeing today.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. And there's sort of two elements of that that I touched on in my article, but I think sort of a through line in the work that I've seen and done at Media Matters for years, which is one, sort of the role that mainstream outlets have, not just in rebutting inaccurate information, but in sort of proactively positing accurate and useful framings. And the second element of that is sort of the way that right-wing media is able to fill a void, whether it's intentional or not, and continue to kind of have message discipline and consistently reinforce inaccurate information. And I think a great example of that would be, you know, in consistent coverage of even the leak, I think there's a tendency to, we saw a tendency to sort of center, you know, the political process and center the horse race sort of element, like who is this a win for? Who's the winner? Who's the loser? All of these sort of things that make for, you know, interesting political commentary, but sort of miss the point where it's like, hey, the conversation we're having right now is one of access, and one that the framing is happening in largely right-wing terms.
And when we have these, you know, framed it in the right, not the right way, but the right way, that automatically shifts whatever narrative it is that the media is trying to convey. So even if a CNN or an MSNBC, if they do one of these segments and they end up down these right-wing rabbit holes, it becomes very difficult to pull back out and, as you say, you know, get to the more accurate info, because you're spending the time rebutting without saying, yes, okay, all of this is false. This is not true. This is unimportant. But here, you know, they've got 8-minute segments, you know, 5-minute segments sometimes. They got to move on to that next thing. And so you run out of time, unfortunately, because of the way these shows are designed, to really get into these issues. And that's why I think a lot of it with this independent media and the podcasts and things like that, we're able to take a deep dive into these things. But obviously, none of us, unless your name is Joe Rogan or if you're on the far right, none of us have the reach that these big corporate outlets have. To get this full interview and access to the complete Ring of Fire podcast archives, sign up at rofpodcast.com and become a member.